You can email me at communications@virtualmarine.ca. So I'm Allison Crawford. I'm the marketing specialist here at Virtual Marine. I'll be your host for today. And I am shortly going to pass it over to Robert Rumbolt, our Director of Operations. I'll briefly introduce Robert and give you a little bit of background. So as I said, Robert is the Director of Operations in charge of a team of hardware engineers, technicians, and production personnel here at Virtual Marine. Robert is a graduate of Lakehead University's Mechanical Engineering program, building upon a diploma in industrial engineering technology from College of North Atlantic here in Newfoundland, Labrador. So Robert has been working in simulation design, fabrication, and accreditation for over 9 years. I actually think it's longer than that now. During that time, he has held official positions of product realization engineer, mechanical engineer, and project manager here at Virtual Marine. So he specializes in mechanical design and management of various projects. I can attest to that he's managing them all the time. And he's scaling from desktop park task training systems to fully enclosed motion-enabled simulators, which he will showcase to you today. So I am going to hand it over to you, Robert, and take it away.
Okay, thank you, Allison. So, Allison, are we on the front page of the presentation here?
We are on the front page of the presentation, yes.
Okay, yes, yeah, so thank you. So like Allison mentioned, I guess this is part two of a four-part webinar series that we're putting together here. Our president and the CEO, Tony Patterson, I guess, debriefed last week or a couple weeks ago, I guess, on the regulatory side. So today I'm going to primarily focus on, hardware aspects with sort of our product line. So the title of this is actually what types of simulators are there, and is there hardware available to enhance the training experience? So the way I approach this, I'm actually sort of going to reference some sample projects that we've done, different points in time, different parts of the world, actually. And I think that should give everybody a good idea of, the broad array of hardware that's available, and touching on that scaling, right from a laptop and a virtual reality headset on up to full motion system. So that's going to be the focus of what I'm going to speak to today. Okay, so the slide right here, really what I'm the focus is on the right-hand side here, where you see what are some hardware options. But our product line is very customizable. So we've got a very modular, versatile platform that you can interchange different boat types. So I've got a few shown here on the left-hand side. You can do like a davit launch lifeboat, free fall lifeboat, single fall lifeboat. Then you've got fast rescue boat and fast rescue craft. So each one of these categories has, depending on the manufacturer, could have numerous types of boats that fit into these categories. So in our lifetime, we've done the bulk of them, you know what I mean? So if we haven't done it, we tackle it just like we have. And in most cases, we already have it in our kit. So you can sort of select what lifeboat you want, select what rescue boat you want, and you can, the next little thing there is the launch facilities. So depending on where you want to launch your boat, you can from an oil rig or a drill ship, an FPSO, offshore fishing vessel, a flotel, ferry, all of those. There's generic formats, but there's also very customized elements that you can put in there. So if you come to us with, I want some sort of shipping vessel, name it, name your boat type, and then we go from there. Okay, so that concept is this very much the same on the hardware side. So sort of categorized it into, I guess we've got five here. You can have motion, non-motion. There's a variety of visual systems you can select, I guess, but they would come down to virtual reality versus non-virtual reality. We have the ability to make it mobile in terms of mounting into the trailer or in cases that you can ship around. One of the key things that we pride ourselves on is we incorporate actual boat equipment. So the original equipment manufacturers, equipment, which is actually key on the regulatory side. They may require that you do that. And we'll touch briefly on, you know, if you want more than a single person training, there's modules that we can add in terms of you can operate a davit or a winch, or you can be a hook man using the hook trainer. Okay, so like I said, the flavor here is going to be, I'm just going to speak to some projects that we've done in the past, and, you know, I'm going to sort of state what the challenge was and then how we sort of tackled that. So we really pride ourselves on being, you know, problem solvers, and, you know, so if anything seems a bit out of the box or a bit off the chart, we've got a process to handle that. So with this one, basically the challenge was, so a client requested us to design a custom full mission simulator, but the kicker was that they wanted it to travel internationally, and they wanted a design such that an attendant could set the system up within 2 hours after it arrives. So, you know, that was the challenge. And then the curriculum itself had to be embedded into the simulator, and you had to be able to pull those records for compliance reasons. So we have done autonomous simulators in offshore settings before, but, you know, they were permanent. Like I said, this one, they actually needed to, like, set it up in the UK, train their guys, send it to the Middle East, train their guys or gals, and then I think it traveled back to the United States after that. So I'm going to just show a couple-minute video here, and I think that'll give a good overview of the autonomous functionality, and I'll just spend a minute or so after we watch the video. So, Allison, you let me know if it's ready to play, if it looks good.
It looks good to ready to play, yes.
Okay.
Battery one.
Roger, battery one.
Battery's dead, switch to battery two.
Roger, battery two.
Survivor ECC, this is Lifeboat 4. We have 53 people on board. We are all secure and standing by, over. Everyone secure. Launching.
Roger. Launching.
Everyone secure. Prepare for splashdown. Explorer, Lifeboat 4. Roger. Proceeding to the west of the platform. Over. Calvert Seeker. This is Lifeboat 4. Over.
Lifeboat 4, Calvert Seeker. Go ahead. Over.
Calvert Seeker, this is Lifeboat 4. We have cleared away and are awaiting instructions. Over.
Okay, so I'll just stop that video right there. So yeah, you sort of see sort of the gentleman inside the box, a colleague of mine, Phil Crowley, is actually one of our senior programmers here. So he's role-playing a student going through the embedded curriculum within that simulator. So the simulator, again, it was custom designed. It is actually an SSI lifeboat with their specific controls. The client wanted us to have it launch from their rig and embed their emergency response procedures. So that's the way the system was set up. Okay. And again, I guess the primary challenge was how do you make it and design it such that it can fit into those cases in the left-hand corner there and ship around the world. So it was quite successful. I think the period between 2015 and 2018, just know these numbers off the top of my head here, that I think they ran over 600 simulations like I said, the UK, Middle East, and the US. And they did come back to us afterwards and actually asked us to integrate a hook trainer module with that system as well, which we did at a later project. So now a hook trainer also travels with this system. Okay. So next sort of little sample project that we worked on. So we pride ourselves on, like I mentioned before, working with actual boat controls. I guess there's no better example than that than what we did a few years back. So the challenge was our client, basically their objective, they want to build the most advanced lifeboat simulator in the world. And the idea was to use an actual lifeboat that they had in their yard. So we worked with that client and designed, certified an actual lifeboat to fit within a cradle that could be placed on a motion bed. We then sort of wrapped our normal simulation infrastructure around that. That is basically taking an actual lifeboat and placing it on the bed. So I've got a quick little video to show the end result of that as well. This video is not as long. I think it's a minute or so. So Allison, I'll get you to give the thumbs up again. Yeah, good.
Yes, you're ready to go.
Okay. Okay, so yeah, the video was a little crude, but hopefully it gets the point across. It's quite an impressive system. Now, that was done a few years back, and we've since moved on to our Q20 platform. So I think the visuals that were presented on the wall there via the projector, that would have been the previous version of software. So, but we'll speak to some of that now in a second as well. So I think Allison had mentioned if, you know, at the end of this, we can take some questions. But if there's anything specific as I sort of talk to any of these projects or some of the videos that I'm flashing up there, you can please type in that chat portal as well. Okay. So I'm just going to spend a minute. I don't have a video to go along with this one, but I do have a few pictures of the end result. So this project entailed, trainees normally attending a facility, they had a strategic plan to basically place two free fall full mission simulators in a trailer that they could bring to their client site. Okay, so that was the challenge. We had placed smaller simulators in a trailer before, but this one we actually had to place two with a shared integrated instructor station. So again, we worked with the client to custom design the mounting infrastructure for the trailer. And that allowed them to place two free fall lifeboat simulators that had never been deployed in that country before on a mobile setting. Okay, so these are sort of some after we installed in the trailer. So there's a big fisheye in the top two pictures here, but it sort of gives the idea. I'm just going to activate my pointer here. So here is actually the door to to get in between. The door is actually at the midpoint of the trailer, and you walk in, and the simulators are sort of facing stern to stern. But you walk in on the left-hand side, you walk into a guest 40. If you walk into the right-hand side, you walk into an FF48. Okay. So next little item I want to touch on. So this is probably a specialized project, but I think it's maybe important to note in terms of capabilities of, and the modularity in both the hardware side and software. So a few years back, and I guess it was as a result of a helicopter crash here in offshore Newfoundland, a local training provider, they identified a need following, the inquiry into that helicopter crash for enhanced training. And I guess it was really what they wanted to focus on was the critical phases of helicopter flight, takeoff and landing, but also those critical couple seconds just as you enter the water, in terms of bracing yourself and preparing yourself for what comes next. So I think anyone who's done a basic survival training course, you'll always remember what the helicopter underwater evacuation trainer or the Hewitt is all about. This simulator fit the need in that it was the prelude to that. So like a Hewitt, it's, you sort of start the simulation when you're just about to enter the water. This simulator focused on, you actually take off from a rig and even you board the helicopter in the way you would that they direct you offshore. You hear the pilot commands, the engine noise, the rotors, and obviously you get to feel what a flight sort of looks and feels like. And then it was sort of designed such that for ditching, so they could be controlled ditches or uncontrolled ditches. So again, it's done with our simulation platform and our core hardware platform, but it's obviously we're a maritime industry simulation group, but this was a jump to the aviation side. So again, I've got a video here that I'm going to flash up. I may not play all of it, just want to get the important points here.
You're good to roll.
Good, okay.
Thank you. stabilized surface. The scan machines will be teed up flat. After the engines and the rotor blades are stopped, we will come back and direct you to the right routes.
Okay, so so look, that scenario file that we just loaded there, that was a control ditch, again, critical phase of flight. It was just a takeoff from an FPSO. Something went wrong with the helicopter and they had to put the helicopter in the water. So obviously that's a bit of a nightmare situation, but it gives the trainees that head to that facility a chance to prepare themselves. Now, just realized in the video that the guys did not do what they were supposed to do. I think they had a good chuckle when they landed down on water, but it gives an opportunity to practice the brace position. And key component that they wanted to focus on was that if the impact is great enough, the seats would stroke. So body position is critical, and if it's incorrect position, there's going to be damage to your lower limbs and your chance the helicopter escape is lower. Okay, so again, that's our older visualization system, pre-Q20. But this software is available in Q20, which allows us to use technology such as virtual reality. Okay, which I'm going to touch on now. So, this is a bit of a hot topic in this industry, incorporating virtual reality. Augmented reality. So the big need arose really in the fast rescue boat side, and users would identify a gap. If you just have three television screens, you sort of lose perspective. Let's just say you were coming alongside to pick somebody up. You would always, you could implement a joystick control to adjust your camera, but that you sort of lose some realism there as well. So that was the initial gap that it closed, and it's a cost-effective solution to that problem. And some of these big, you can get projection-based systems, but obviously they're very, very expensive, and that could be prohibitive to somebody moving ahead with the simulation solution. So again, with the Q20 platform in place, it allowed us to move to that. So just going to quickly show one of the first fire-ups of Fast Rescue Boat Virtual Reality. So can you see the video, Allison?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. Okay, so this was a rescue boat scenario that we had in our kit for a while. Obviously, there's a fairly large issue with an oil installation. It's on fire listing, and your rescue boat crew on board a supply vessel. that's standing by. So the objective was to put the rescue boat in the water, and, you know, there's life rafts and personnel in the water that you would need to locate. So again, that's a little snippet of just that scenario. And basically, we've already launched, cleared away, made our way towards the oil and gas platform. So yeah, that was a big venture to us to get this working. But now that was a couple of years ago, now that it is working, we sort of deployed that across our product line. So in terms of lifeboat, fast rescue boat, the helicopter ditching, it's all capable of integrating that hardware. And not just for the user itself. We just worked on a project, actually, a fast rescue boat where it was multi-person and there was multiple VR players in the one scene. So you had not only the boat driver, but you had the person operating the winch in terms of the davit controls. He was in virtual reality as well. Okay. So again, all this is embedded into a curriculum program, which is recorded and can be retrieved later for, like I said, compliance reasons. Okay, just head back to the presentation. So with virtual reality in our wheelhouse, lots of places you can go with that. So we work closely with one of our clients to tackle the issue of pre-launch inspection for a lifeboat. So the particular procedure that they wanted us to work on had 37 steps in it, you know, of communication with, you know, the bridge, different members of your team. And, you know, the only way they could practice that was actually on board the ship itself and doing a drilled exercise. So the idea was, okay, can we do this shore base to get the team familiarized and, again, make it very equipment specific? So what we did, completely modeled the asset they were launching from, the lifeboat and the davit system, and then incorporated that pre-launch procedure from the client itself. So in terms of who would talk to who and what would they say. So again, I've got a couple minute video here just to illustrate how that works.
Video's ready, Robert.
Okay. So just gonna...
For damage, wear, ice, or debris. At the forehook station, you also need to ensure that the painter line is connected and properly secured to the lifeboat. Now, call the bridge and ask permission to remove the service slings connected to both hooks. Again, you make the radio call by pressing the grip button on the controller and selecting the service slings radio call. Read aloud the radio call and press continue. The bridge will return the radio call, granting permission to remove the service slings. The bridge requests that you call back when the lifeboat checks have been completed. At the forehook station, choose to remove the service sling that is connected to the hook. Before you leave the forehook station, confirm the state of the hook, wires, painter, and service sling. Navigate back to the aft hook station and choose to remove the service sling. Again, confirm the state of the aft hook, wire, and service sling before moving on. Maneuver to the underside of the lifeboat's bow in order to locate the emergency system valve on the front side of the davit. Ensure that the valve is in the on position and confirm the state. Head back up to the lifeboat entrance labeled cable/door. Now, unplug the electrical cable. From here, open the hatch, which will allow entry to the lifeboat interior. Inside the lifeboat, navigate to the battery/launch station. Ensure that the launching wires are free and ready to use, with the orange line in the bag and the green line available. Next, move the battery selector switch from the off position to one of the on positions. The lifeboat can be launched on battery 1 or battery 2. Next, remove
Okay, so hopefully you get the point of what was going on there. So that video was actually captured during the project just to show sort of progress. It wasn't finalized at that point, but I just pulled that video for reference. So yeah, we've since developed virtual reality pre-launch inspection trainers for the lifeboat fleet, you know, so davit, free fall, single fall, and rescue boat has been tackled now as well. So, you know, that's the process. It can be very specific to someone's needs, or it can be more of a generic format. Okay, so this is also gaining traction in terms of what can you do in terms of maintenance and inspection of your assets. So same sort of philosophy where you sort of present choices to a student and they have to make the appropriate choices, and the software is checking to see if you're on point or not. And, you know, once you complete the exercise, it'll let you know if you passed or not. You as an administrator can view those records and see how your crew or your trainees have done. Okay. So, you know, and that PLI is critical because the lifeboat simulator itself, at that point, you're sitting in the coxswain's chair ready to launch. But if you think about it, in that client's instance, there's actually 37 steps that you needed to do appropriately before you even get to in that chair. So that's the way this is structured, is that pre-launch inspection software comes with the lifeboat simulator itself, if you choose so, and it allows you to, you know, the full package. Okay, so build upon that, you know, that sort of software application is fantastic technology. But some of the challenges that you may encounter is that regulators actually may require you to integrate actual equipment. You know, I know firsthand, Transport Canada, you need to have LSA code lifeboat equipment in your simulator if you choose to go that route. So a straight up virtual reality solution is not going to suffice. So, thing we had to tackle here was that, okay, how do you continue to use the actual lifeboat equipment but blend in that technology in terms of virtual reality? So it's, you know, we sort of label it mixed reality. So yeah, your hands are very much in the real world where you get to touch the actual equipment, but your eyes are in a virtual setting. So I've just got a quick little video here to illustrate that concept. Dowson? Yeah.
Okay. Yes.
Let's just have a look around, Carl, at boat port and starboard side. Let's have a look at your windows, port window. Carl? Port window?
Oh, sorry. I thought you were
No, no. Look at your port window.
Oh, just look out the port window?
Yeah. There you go. Starboard. Okay, look down at your dash. There you go.
Okay, so again, quick little example of, I don't know if you could notice there in the video, but as Colin, you know, looked down at the dash, it sort of mapped what he was seeing in the headset one-to-one. So then when he reached out his hand, it was, you know, the equipment was where he thought it would be. And again, it's the real equipment. So so that concept has allowed us to do a lot as well in terms of winch controls and sensing various controls and integrating with that technology. So again, that's probably our smallest platform right there. You notice the size of it. It fits on a desk. And, you know, but when you put on the headset, you're in a lifeboat. So just sort of the way we offer it is that you do the pre-launch inspection software in virtual reality, and then you sort of transfer through the simulator to complete scenarios. Okay, so that's the same for any of the lifeboat offerings, Davit, free fall, single fall, or any of the rescue boat. And again, the philosophy is that you can place any boat that you want to in that scene, any launch asset, and it works in the software. Okay. So, again, challenge put to us by, again, some clients. So if you looked at the left-hand side here, got three different lifeboat types. So there's numerous, you know, installations around the world that have different lifeboats and different manufacturers of lifeboats on the same installation. But, you know, the requirement could be you need to train on equipment that is specific to that rig. So, like, okay, so how do you do that? Of course, you can place individual simulators on a rig, but, you know, let's just say you have three or four different lifeboat types. That's three or four different simulators. So there's two big things there that would be a problem, is that the cost associated with doing so, and, you know, there isn't a lot of room, right? So what we sort of came up with was the ability to change in and change out components on our platform. So you'll notice, I'll just get the pointer here. Maybe I'll switch it to. So like this sort of notice here, that is a Beihai BH9 hook release handle. Right? So if you were doing training on that lifeboat, you would place this wing. Okay, so then when you put on the headset, you're on the interior of a BH9, and you look down, you've got the release handle. But then, okay, let's just say you've got another release handle that you need to replicate, and that would be a NorSafe JYN, so right here. So basically the idea is that remove bolts, take off one handle, put on the other, and then you activate another version of software. That's exactly what we've done here. Okay, so again, same philosophy on the fast rescue boat side, or lifeboat, for instance. Let's just say you've got different propulsion systems. You could have a fast rescue boat, for instance, that has it's a single outboard, but you could have dual outboards that require twin sticks, right? So the idea is that, okay, you take off a throttle module, put on a different one to allow you to complete training on that specific equipment. This way, it's very cost effective, and it's a fairly small footprint, and you're really leveraging the technology that's available. Okay. So it's 10 after one, so I'm closing on the end here. Just going to give an example of a challenge put forward to us by a group in the Canadian Arctic, and that they wanted to run proficiency in survival craft and rescue boat courses approved by Transport Canada, like I said, in their territory. Previously, they'd have to actually send their students, they'd actually come here to Newfoundland to do the training. And so you can imagine the cost associated with bringing a full class in for a week to do that. And there's other challenges associated with that. So, you know, they wanted to do it locally, which made a lot of sense. Fortunately, in the Arctic, I don't know, 9-10 months of the year, it's very difficult to put the boat in the water. So again, perfect case for simulation. So again, our approach was, and build these systems very robust, You know, we put them on offshore installations. We put them in areas that are quite difficult to get to. But this technology is approved by a regulator, and you know, this is available in the Canadian Arctic. So people can actually train at that facility, and you know, they get their certification right there. And since then, so our initial, I've got a picture of the initial deployment. So they've got lifeboat with hook trainers and a fast rescue boat, but they've also identified a need. You know, you've got 12 trainees in a classroom, and 3 to 4 people use a simulator at a time. They wanted, you know, I don't know if occupy is the correct word or not, but you know, they a chance for, you know, there's some downtime there. So they actually went forward and integrated desktop simulators to sort of, okay, that downtime can now be utilized. People practice on this desktop system before they go into to the big unit. And so that system, on that platform, you can do lifeboat training, which that was the video that I showed with Colin, right? I think you get that. But you activate a different software program using the same hardware, you can actually do rescue boat training on that as well. I think you saw the video of me, you know, all rig was on fire on the rescue boat crew. So you can do that with this kit. And there's also, in terms of they wanted to tackle challenges in terms of competencies in the bridge watch program, in terms of rules of road and nav aids, you can flash up a workboat program and do scenarios focusing. Oh, that's a horrible sketch there, but you get the idea. They can launch workboat program. Okay. So I guess sort of what's coming next, they're seriously considering integration of 2 other modules with their, because again, Transport Canada is looking at the same thing that they did with the lifeboat simulation. They're looking at doing with the rescue boat side. Again, they're going to require that you need to operate a winch and you need to operate the actual hook equipment. But this could be integrated with, let me just go back a slide here, with this desktop here. So you add in 2 modules, it becomes a 3-person trainer. And now you can do rescue boat training in the Arctic as well. Okay. So this, I think this is the last slide, and open it up to questions if anyone has any. And I just look here, something that's come up fairly recently is, okay, just spoke to that workboat software, and I didn't really focus this webinar on our sort of defense and military side where we, you know, do embedded bridge simulation. But during one of our defense projects, we developed azimuth controls. So look, same philosophy, we developed a control that could work within virtual reality setting. So the ask was, can you place those azimuth controllers and chair orientation in virtual reality around the workboat program? Right? So that's the type of questions that we field on a regular basis. And that's the type of technology that we put out there. Right? So hopefully that's the focus, is that it's very versatile, modular in terms of, you know, what you want to do. And there's always the ability to add on after the fact, or if you don't consider that up front.
Great. Thank you, Robert. So what I will do now is I'm actually